it's beyond my control. Anyways, so as we all are here to discuss about Porsche, before much ado, let me just share my presentation with you all, so it will be easy for you to understand what this act is. Okay, before going ahead, I would like to see, you can put it in the chat box, that what is your understanding about this act? How many of you know about this act? If you have any idea about this act, you can write yes in the chat box. And if it is the first time you are attending this session, you can write no. So accordingly, I will put in my efforts here. Yes, please. I'm waiting for the answers. Those, it's the first time, they can write, okay. So Shekhar, you know about it, that what this act is. Okay, who else? Manbir, you haven't heard about it. Okay. Yes, may I see the ladies responding to this? Naina, no. Okay. Okay. Anjali, no. Okay. So, I will try and explain it to you in a layman's language and a simple language so that you understand that what this act is, because the language of law is, Rajeshwari, you're saying that I heard about it, but not in detail. Okay. So, before going ahead, let me just explain it to you that what was the need of this act, you know, being Indian, being from the Indian culture, the background, you know. There was a period when Kali Mata, Lakshmi Mata and all were not there, and the woman was supposed to be the suppressed human being on the earth, wherein the women were considered as a housemaker. They were supposed to take care of the children. They were not supposed to get out of the house. They were not supposed to work out of the house, you know. So that during that time, a lot of cases has happened. And the government realized that there is no such act which actually prevents the ladies from sexual harassment. Before, when we go ahead, I have few slides in the presentation in which I will explain you from where this law is being generated. So in this particular session, let me just start. I call my session as sexual harassment drawing the line. Sexual harassment is nothing but to draw a line. I give you an example. Suppose I work in an organization and I work with a male colleague. One of my male colleagues is calling me baby, honey, sweetheart. I am comfortable with that. Another male colleague who works with me in the same department, if he's calling me baby, honey, sweetheart, and I am not comfortable with that, it can be considered as the sexual harassment. So as we going back to the mythological stories, you remember that Lakshman ji has drawn a Lakshman Rekha around Sita and told Sita not to step out of that Lakshman Rekha. That Lakshman Rekha is the sexual harassment, which is determined by the lady. That, okay, this is my line, please don't cross it. If you cross this line, then you will be in trouble. So sexual harassment is nothing but any gesture, anything, any comment, any gesture or any act which a lady is uncomfortable with. It can be even sending good morning or hi messages from a person she would not like to interact with. If she's receiving such kind of messages on a regular basis from a person whom she's not comfortable with, that particular act can be considered as the sexual harassment in the language of law. So I call my session as drawing the line, because that line is different for everyone. For me, that line, you know, for if somebody who knows me for many years and has been working with me for many years, and he's calling me a honey or a sweetheart, I'm comfortable with that particular gesture. For me, that line of that person can be a little far off. But somebody whom I'm not comfortable with, and I feel that this person doesn't look at me in a particular way I expect him to look at, and if he's calling me sweetheart and honey and I'm not comfortable, that can be considered as the sexual harassment. So going further, as we go down with the slides, you will understand that how deep this law is, how deep this act is. So now again, I throw you the questions here. I want the audience to please participate in this, because I want the session to be very, very interactive. What, according to you, can be considered as the sexual harassment? You can put it in the chat box. Let me just see, you know, how much you can, think about it. What, according to you, can be considered as the sexual harassment? I want to see. Yes, please. What, according to you, can be considered as the sexual harassment? What, according to you, any particular act, any particular gesture which you feel is considered as the sexual harassment for a lady? I want the answers, please. Start typing in. Please start typing in. Okay, wrong approach to girls by teasing. Okay, teasing can be a verbal teasing, a physical touch. Okay, very good, Rajeshwari. Who else? What, according to you, can be considered as the sexual harassment for a lady? Girls, I can see Naina, Anjali, everyone here. I want this session to be more interactive. I don't want to speak continuously and, you know, make it a very monotonous session. Okay. So I guess you guys are either sleepy or you are never been harassed in your life ever, which is quite impossible. According to the research, any girl who is working in an organization and is above 35, 40, once in her lifetime, she has experienced sexual harassment. As per the research of the Indian working culture research, none of the girl in Indian society so far, you will come across who has not faced a sexual harassment ever. Sometimes in the bus, sometimes on the road, sometimes in the organization. Once in our life, we all would have experienced it. So I wanted the answer from you, but I guess there's not much participation from the audience. Okay, I got one more answer. Let me see. Unwanted touching or leaning over. Definitely, yes. That is known as invading the personal space. Every girl has got a personal space. Every girl has got a, you know, as I told you, the Lakshman Rekha. And if someone crosses that, it is considered as the sexual harassment. Yes. Okay, so moving ahead, let me just brief you about this law, about this act. According to this law, the types of sexual harassment are divided into two broad categories. One is quid pro quo. Quid pro quo means is a clear-cut sexual harassment where the supervisor or the manager whom the girl is working with clearly asks the sexual favors. He says that you do me this, then I give you a promotion. If you do this to me, I will give you increment. If you do this to me, I will give your leave sanctioned. You know, your leave will be sanctioned. This is give and take kind of, deal between the supervisor and the manager and the girl who's working under it. Okay, just for your knowledge, such kind of things generally do not happen at the middle level management. These kind of things happen either very, very low level, like, you know, you see these casual workers, or you see uneducated ladies doing the work on the road, or, you know, doing the domestic help in the house, these kind of category of people, or on a very, very high level, like, you know, VPs and CEOs of the company where, you know, the page three kind of a level. Such kind of favors are not being asked in the middle management because today's girl is an educated one, and, they know their good and their bad. You see, now the curriculum is being changed, you know, that in first, second, third standard, children have, life skill classes where they are being taught about the good touch and the bad touch. So these kind of things do not happen at the middle level management. Quid pro quo generally happens at the very, very low level or very, very high level. The type of sexual harassment which is common in the middle level management or in the society where we live is the hostile work environment. Hostile work environment is that because of the sexuality of a girl, just because she's a girl, you are judging her performance. I give you an example. Suppose if I'm working in an organization and my boss is a male and he's very fond of my work, you know, he always appreciates my work and he always says that I'm a very good, you know, worker, I'm a very hard worker. And I get a promotion in a very short time. Say, for example, if we are a team of 10 people, some people are working in the organization for 3 years. But I just worked for 1 year and I get the promotion which a 5-year-old employee deserves because of my work, because of my hard work, because of my professionalism. People will judge my performance. People will say that, okay, you know, the boss is very fond of this girl. This girl must be doing what not to please the boss. And that's the reason why she's being given this promotion. Now, what if my boss is a lady? Or what if I am a male? Nobody will judge my performance based on my sexuality. Just because I am a girl and my boss is a male and I'm performing well. And that's the reason why I've been promoted. And people are judging me. People are, you know, questioning my relationship with my boss just because I'm a female. This is known as hostile work environment, wherein the work culture of the organization, the environment around me is made in such a way that it becomes difficult for me to work in an organization. When I go to the organization, people are looking at me with a question mark. People are looking at me when I'm talking to my boss in a different way, with a different eye. You know, I have been judged about my performance because I am a girl, because I'm a woman. That is known as hostile work environment, which is very, very common in our society, which is very, very common in the middle level management. Now, I have a question again for all of you. I told you that somebody questioning someone's performance because of the sexuality can be considered as the sexual harassment in the eye of a law. So I want to ask you, can a girl book another girl? Please understand the question. Can a girl book another girl in the case of a sexual harassment? Is it possible? Can a girl be sexually harassed by another girl? Don't think about the LBQT and, you know, in those lines. I'm talking about the working culture. Okay, I get an answer. Yes, of course. Yes, Shekhar. A girl can be booked by another girl under the case of sexual harassment because hostile work environment is creating somebody's work environment, negative work environment around the person. Yes, there are so many cases like that. I'll not name the company, but I just give you a case study wherein 34 employees were booked under the sexual harassment case by a girl. And amongst those 34 employees, there were few girls and few boys. It was a very renowned IT company. So it is possible for a girl to book another girl under the sexual harassment case. Why? Because that particular girl has made the situation in such a way that it becomes difficult for a woman employee to work in that environment. So it is very, very important, you know, if somebody is commenting on your clothes, somebody is commenting on your body, somebody commenting on your hair, on your makeup, even if it is a girl and you are not liking it. So in that case, you know, you can always book that person. And please understand, sexual harassment is not one-time comment. This is the problem most of the companies face. I'll explain you when I go in the detail of this law. I will explain you how it works in the organization. Who do not have their ICs, Medanta Hospital Gurgaon is being fined with a huge amount by the government, by the Ministry of Women and Child Development, because there was no IC in that hospital. So it is a very important act. It is a very important law, you know, because keeping all these Nirbhaya cases and all these cases in mind, government is really coming up very heavily on the organization, those who are not following this act. It is a mandatory act. Okay, so as per the law, the sexual harassment is divided in 4 groups. First is the verbal. verbal sexual harassment can be any word, any you know, double meaning sentence, or any particular slang which a girl is not comfortable with, or abuse. You know, these kind of things are considered as the verbal sexual harassment. If you have any question, you can raise your hand. I'll be more than happy to answer your questions, please. Another important thing is written. Written is writing something, sending messages. These WhatsApp messages are being, you know, are a big chaos these days. I come across with many such things in the organization wherein, you know, a WhatsApp message is being sent to a girl. And now, you know, with this new working style where people are working from home, virtual sexual harassments are happening, which is mostly written and visual. All these things comes under written. Another one is visual. Visual is, according to the law, if a person is staring at a girl for more than 20 seconds and the girl is not comfortable, can be considered as the sexual harassment. So I'm sure that there will be many male members in this session. So it's a reminder for them that, you know, if those elevation look, they call it the elevator look, and the elevation look, wherein you look up to a girl from top to bottom and the girl is not comfortable, it can be considered as the sexual harassment in the language of law. Or showing any object or any pornography to a girl, or any objectionable picture in which the girl is not comfortable, is considered as the visual sexual harassment. Another one is physical, which is a complete no-no. There is no excuse about it. You know, somebody touching you, rubbing you, brushing against you, touching any part of yours, blocking your way, coming very close in your proximity. Somebody has just said in the chat box that, you know, coming very close or coming, invading the private space of a girl, this can be considered as the sexual harassment. Now, coming back to the law, I'll just give you a brief story how this law started. In one of the villages in Rajasthan, there was a lady called Bhavri Devi. And this lady used to work with an NGO, and this NGO used to work to stop the child marriages. What happened is that in 1992, Bhavri Devi had went to a prestigious family's house where the child marriage was happening, and she stopped that child marriage. And that particular family was a very renowned family of that village. So 5-6 members of that family, that renowned family, raped Bhavri Devi and, you know, performed the child marriage and everything just to teach her a lesson. So that NGO, the name of the NGO was Vishakha. That NGO fought that case for Bhavri Devi. And in 1997, Supreme Court issued are guidelines to all the organization, which is known as Vishakha guidelines. Vishakha guidelines are the guidelines which are being issued by the Supreme Court to all the organization working in India, wherein anyone who's working in an organization, it is the employer's responsibility to protect that person. Person as a woman. This law is only for women. Men are not covered under this law. So, These guidelines ensure that if a lady is going in an organization, if a lady is working in an organization, it is the employer's responsibility to protect and secure that lady from any sexual harassment. Now, what has happened is that, the employer was responsible for protecting the lady. What about when the lady is going out of the organization? What about when the lady is traveling from the organization to her own house? The acid attacks and all these things started happening. Then in 2013, this act was being made, which is known as Prevention of Sexual Harassment of Women at the Workplace. So in this particular act, see, there is a difference between a guideline and an act when we talk about the language of law. Act is applicable to every Indian citizen. So any woman who is citizen of India, this act is applicable for that. So every woman is covered under this act. So in 2013, this act was being made by the Supreme Court. And protection of women, or you know, protecting the womanism of a woman is considered as the human right. A woman's sexuality or a woman's womanhood can be protected, saying that this is my right. I have right to work, I have right to live, I have right to protect my womanhood. So this is known as right to protect the dignity of a woman, and this act has covered all these parts. A woman can work now in a night shift, in a day shift, wherever you see those, you know, I've been out and I've seen a Zomato lady, delivery girl, you know, a Zomato or a Swiggy delivery girl. This all, you know, because it is, the time is changing, and the employers, those who employ the woman, are very, very conscious about their security. They're very, very conscious about their well-being, you know. So these changes are happening in the society. And why? Because of these acts which are being made by the government is empowering women to be more independent. We feel more secure because of these kind of acts. So this is the background behind the law. I'll just share this law with you. The sexual harassment of women at workplace. Prevention means to prevent any sexual harassment. To prohibit, there should not be any sexual harassment of a woman at the workplace. And redressal. Suppose if anything happens to a woman, the redressal should also happen. This is a act under in which all the organization are covered. So what is the objective of the act? Is to prevent, protect and redressal. The act provides a civil remedy to women and is in addition to other laws that are currently in force. We have different laws for women, domestic violence ka hai, you know, the dowry and all that are there. That is separate. This act is for the woman working in an organization. It is employer's responsibility to prevent, prohibit and redressal if any such case happens. Any sexually harassed woman at the workplace has the right to take recourse of both civil and criminal proceeding. It is up to a woman how she wants that sexual harassment case to be addressed. When we move ahead, I'll explain you a little bit more. There are two ways. As I told you, that this act is applicable for any organization who has got more than 10 employees. So suppose if I go to a ICICI bank to deposit a check and there I got sexually harassed, where I can go? I can go to the IC of the ICICI bank. Now, what if I go to a parchuni shop or a grocery shop where there is one owner and two salesmen and I get sexually harassed there? Then where should I go? Because the act says any employer having more than 10 employees. In that particular case, there is only one owner and two employees. That means the IC is not there. Then how am I protected? In that case, there is another body known as LCC, which is known as Local Complaint Committee. Every police station, every district, every city, every township has got a Local Complaint Committee. It's just that the awareness is not there. A lady who's sexually harassed, or suppose if a domestic help, you know, a domestic help, a woman is coming in my house and something happens to her, then who's responsible? Where should she go? She goes to LCC, where that she can go and register her sexual harassment complaint. And the LCC, Local Complaint Committee, will handle this case and do the further proceedings. Please raise the hand if you have any questions. Okay, this act is applicable to the whole India. Every organization having more than 10 employees. Who can be the aggrieved person? Anyone who's a female. This act is only for female, irrespective of age, irrespective of the status, single, married, divorcee. And it can be the employee of the organization or an outsider. Suppose if I go to a bank and something happens to me, the bank is responsible for my safety. The IC of the bank, if something happens to me, I can go to the IC of the bank and complain there. Suppose the harasser is also an outsider. I go to a bank and I have been harassed by the customer of the bank. The person is not the employee of the bank. Still, the IC of the bank is responsible for my safety. Still, the IC of the bank will make sure that I get a proper, you know, attention. If I need to go to a police station or a LCC, they will provide me everything. Suppose if the local complaint committee or the police station needs any CCTV or any witnesses from the bank or something, the IC of the bank is responsible to provide it. Any questions so far? Okay. Now, according to the language of the law, who is the employee? Employee can be anyone, a regular, a temporary, a ad hoc, with or without remuneration, voluntary, direct through an agent, contractor, daily wager, domestic worker, prohibitioner, apprentice, anyone who is entering the premises of an organization, a trainee, a contract, an agent. Suppose if, you know, I am going at my husband's office to meet him or to give him lunch, then if something happens to me in that premises, I am also covered under this act. The IC of the organization is responsible for my security. The IC of the organization is responsible for my safety. So according to the language of the law, an employee can be anyone. So that means any female who's entering the premises is covered under this. Who's the employer? Employer can be the management, supervisor, anyone who's controlling. Suppose I am a trainer, I go to an organization to deliver my training and something happens to me, then they are the one who's controlling my act. So technically they are my employer. Not necessarily they are paying me for that, but I am under their premises, I am under their control. They are telling me to go in a particular area to deliver the training. So they are responsible for my safety. So according to the law, the definition of employer can be anything. Now, what is a workplace? A workplace can be, as I told you, that the act say protection of the woman employee by the employer at a workplace. So what can be the workplace? It can be private sectors, it can be government sectors, it can be hospitals, hospitality, nursing home, it can be educational institutes, it can be sports institutes, stadiums, it can be domestic workers' place where she's coming and going, working in a house, or anything which is coming in your mind. Every place is covered by this act. There is no excuse. Recently, I'm based in Goa, and recently there was a case here where the swimming coach was being booked under the case of a sexual harassment because he used to teach swimming in a stadium to a girl. That case was a POXO case because the girl was, less than 18 year old. But my point here is to explain you that suppose if I go with my child to that swimming pool and something happens to me, the IC of that stadium is responsible for my safety. That's the reason why, you know, the CCTVs and all are there in all the organization. That's the reason why you see the organization coming up with the open door policies where all the chambers are open, where, you know, there is no walls. It's just the glass. You see these, you know, big MNCs and all, they're coming in with workstations. There is no office. Everyone sit together in a hall without any partition. If anything has to happen, it has to happen in front of everyone. So all these remedies, all these things are to address such issues if such thing happens in an organization. And suppose if I'm traveling any place visited by the employee arising out of or during course of employment, which includes transportation provided by the employer. I am going from my work to my organization and something happens to me in between. As soon as I leave my house, my workplace starts. If something happens to me in between, I'm not saying that IC will be directly responsible for it. But yes, if I am calling up the IC and complaining about the case, it is IC's responsibility to provide me the remedies. Suppose if I'm in a situation where I can't go back or drive back, my company's responsibility is to provide me a vehicle. Suppose if, you know, I'm in such a situation where I have to go to a police station on every off and on and on the hearings of the court or something like that. It is my IC's responsibility to understand this. You know, this will be my leave should be given to me, or proper remedy should be given to me. They should support me if something like that happens. So it is the IC's responsibility to make sure that my sexual harassment case is properly being addressed. Now, what is sexual harassment under the law? Demand or request of sexual favors, which is a very, very straightforward sexual harassment. Showing pornography, unwelcome physical, verbal or non-verbal conduct of sexual nature, physical contact and advances, making sexually colored remark. Oh, you are a girl. That's the reason why you got the promotion. Oh, the boss is very impressed because you wear deep necks. Oh, your perfume, you try and wear such a perfume to impress the boss. These kind of comments are considered as the sexual harassment. There is no excuse about it. Okay, so there are two type of complaint committees. One is the internal complaint committee, which is within the organization. Another one is the local complaint committee, which is outside the organization, which is generally the local police station. Now it is up to the complainant, up to the lady, up to the woman, where she wants to go. She would like to go to her own internal committee, or she would like to go to the local complaint committee. Our internal committee cannot force that woman to come and complain in the internal committee. If the woman doesn't want that internal committee to intervene, it is her choice. She can go to the local complaint committee as well. Internal complaint committee, I'll just give you a brief. Minimum 4 persons should be there, out of which 50% should be women. So basically, if the internal committee is of 4 people, 2 will be women. Rest, 1 can be an outsider. There has to be an outsider also in the internal committee, so that whenever there is a proceeding happening or whenever there is an inquiry happening of a sexual harassment case, there is an outsider also who gives the unbiased views. It is employer's, according to this act, it is employer's obligation to provide a safe working environment, display the workplace details of, the workplace should have the detail of what are the different acts which can be considered as the sexual harassment. What is the composition of IC? Who are the members of IC? Suppose if any sexual harassment happens, then where should the complainant or where should they give the complaint to? All these things should be displayed properly at the workplace. Organize workshop and awareness programs for sanitizing employees. Like many of you today said that this is the first time you are listening about this act, you're listening about this law. This should not happen. Now the problem is not with the government. The problem is with us. We don't know. The remedies are there. The act is there. The things are there in place. Unfortunately, we don't know about it. Organizing orientation program for the members of the IC, that how, if something happens, any sexual harassment case happens, then how someone need to, you know, deal with it. It is IC's responsibility. Cooperate and assist during the course of inquiry. Treat sexual harassment as misconduct under the service rule. Now, many of the organization, they write it in the appointment letter that if there is any sexual harassment conduct which has been proven against an employee, you will be terminated from your services without any questions. Provide assistance to the aggrieved employee should they choose to file a police complaint. Initiate action under the IPC or such other applicable law. Ensure timely submission of the report to the district officer. According to this act, every year the organization, like we file the financial returns, the income tax returns, similarly, the organization has to give a report to the local district officer wherever you are working at present. And if you have more than 10 employees, your HR is doing it. Unfortunately, you don't know about it. So they have to submit a report to the district collector that how many sexual harassment cases are being registered in your organization, how many of them are being addressed, what are the different actions which are being taken against those employees. So the penalties is if a organization is not having IC, then minimum it has to be 50,000. But depending on the financial condition of the company, the penalty can be up to 20, 50 lakhs also. Medanta has paid around 32 lakhs of the penalty by, you know, because they were not having their IC. And worst case, the license of the organization can be cancelled. All offenses under this statute are non-cognizable. Non-cognizable means non-bailable. First, the police will come and arrest and then the inquiry will happen. You know, in murders and all, what happens is that the suspect is being arrested. But suppose if the suspect is not there, then police go do the investigation and then they suspect someone and then arrest. In these cases, in sexual harassment cases, if the girl is complaining about a person, first that person will be arrested and then the inquiry will happen. It is that serious. Any questions? I leave the forum open for all of you now. Any questions? I'll be more than happy to answer your questions, please. And I would like this session to be an interactive one.
Ma'am, in that you have said about the police complaint of aggrieved employee. Can you explain that line again? I can't.
Yes, yes. As I told you that according to this act, there are two ways a aggrieved woman can go. There are two ways she can decide. One is the IC, which is in the organization. She can go to her own internal committee. She can complain to the internal committee about that, particular employee. But if the girl decides, suppose more other than the touching part, somebody tried to kill her, you know, or somebody stole something from her purse. In that case, it can be a IPC also. When she goes to LCC, see, if you see these movies and all, you see that a particular person who's been arrested in a case, then they take different sections name, section 302, section 420, section this, section that. So when a girl is going to a LCC, it can be a IPC also. IPC as in that, you know, that particular person who has molested the girl or sexually harassed the girl can also say that, you know, he tried killing me. Then it comes under IPC. It is a criminal case basically. IPC means that other than the sexual harassment case, that case can be considered as the criminal case. And the proceeding of a criminal case is totally different. There are two type of cases. One is a civil case, one is a criminal case. Sexual harassment comes under the civil case. But the other acts like trying to kill someone, theft, stealing someone, or somebody is trying to do something and any particular organ of a girl, like these Nirbhayas and all are criminal cases wherein the rape has happened, the sexual harassment has happened, but the person has lost life or any particular, you know, organ or unconscious. In those cases, these cases are considered as the criminal proceedings. So it can be a IC or it can be the LCC or it can be the IPC as well, wherein the sexual harassment case can be considered as the criminal case as well.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Ma'am, one more doubt. I have seen some movies, they are taking photo of the girls and taking the bath thing and they have blackmailed them. Yes. Which just comes under civil or crime?
It comes under criminal case. Because blackmailing is a criminal case, taking photograph is a sexual harassment.
Thank you.
Yeah. And somebody has just asked difference between verbal and visual harassment. Verbal harassment is saying something to someone. For example, suppose, you know, I work in an organization where a person is continuously saying me, baby, honey, darling, dear, you know. So, and I told that person that please stop calling me by all these names. I'm not liking it. My name is Kritika. Call me as Kritika. But that person is continuously repeating all that. That is known as sexual harassment. This is known as verbal sexual harassment. That I have told you not to address me with a particular name, but you are not understanding it. You are continuously addressing me with that or abusing, using abusive words. talking some double meaning words. You know, suppose if I'm going home and one of my male colleagues is saying, oh, ma'am, you're looking very nice today in this sari. This color suits you a lot. Oh, ma'am, it seemed that you haven't slept in the night yesterday. Visual harassment is somebody looking at you with a dirty eye, elevation look, somebody looking at you from top to bottom, you know. And most of the girls are present here. I'm sure that you all will agree with me that as a girl, we have a sixth sense that somebody is looking at us. We can tell with what eyes a person is looking at. If it is uncomfortable, if you feel that the person is not looking at you and continuously looking at you with some other different angle and you are not liking it and looking at any of your body part continuously, which you are uncomfortable with, that is known as visual sexual harassment. Plus pornography, you know, showing different photographs, projecting any image, which is a double meaning image, or sending messages, you know, which is on your mobile, any particular picture you're not comfortable with, is considered as the visual sexual harassment. Any more questions, please? So I'm sure after this session, most of the girls, those who are present here, are feeling very empowered. And, you know, we feel very honored and proud that we are protected wherever we are working, whatever we are doing. It gives us a power to stand up for ourselves and say that, hey, we are not liking this particular behavior, stop it. So this is what empowerment is, and this is what this act is all about, to empower us more and to, you know, yeah. Anything else? Yes, Shekhar?
No, I think all done. Yeah. Explained very nicely.
Thank you so much. And thank you so much, everyone. You know, it was a pleasure interacting with you all. Unfortunately, in this short time, I can just give you a capsule dose. The law is actually this big book. So it was a pleasure interacting with you all. And thank you so much, Shekhar, for giving the opportunity.
There is on Rajeshwari.
Yes, sir. We would like to propose a hearty vote of thanks to you, Kritika Chaturvedi, for gracing today's webinar and delivering the important topic on POSH. I'm surely that all the participants have taken note of your suggestion and will increase that further in their career. Lastly, we thank you again on the behalf of RQ Aviation team. Thank you so much, ma'am, for giving your amazing session. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you.